Hey folks, and welcome back to Writer's Bones Friday Coffee. I'm Daniel Ford, and joining me is Sonia Gavankar, the Manager of Public Relations for the Newseum in Washington, D.C. Sonia, welcome to Writer's Bone.
Thanks so much.
All right, so let's start with your background and what you do with the Newseum.
Sure. So I'm a journalist. I have a degree in journalism, and I work as a freelance journalist around town on my off hours. For the Newseum, for the last decade plus, I've been a filmmaker for them. So I produce and edit a lot of their documentaries that appear in the exhibit space, and I appear on camera as well, and now I've just transitioned into their marketing group. So I've been with the museum for a very long time in various capacities, so I feel very one with the organization.
Ah, very nice. I like that. So give us a little bit of history about the museum. How did the original idea come about, and what were some of the guiding principles behind its foundation?
Sure. So the fun thing about the museum is that it was started by journalists, and a lot of the folks who work in our organization come from past experience in journalism. So we are not museum people primarily. We are storytellers, and we have a very different approach to the work of a museum. But now museums really have an expectation of being interactive and being dynamic and having a lot of multimedia. And the museum was on the forefront of that. And that maybe came from journalists, from both the print and broadcasting side, understanding how to tell stories in compelling, dynamic ways. Even though the organization was started by journalists, really our focus is being a champion of the First Amendment and the freedoms that the First Amendment gives us. So it's not just about freedom of the press and freedom of speech, but it's about all the freedoms. And that really is shown by our architecture as well. The museum has the First Amendment chiseled in stone on the front of the building so that when a motorcade does go by with dignitaries, they do see that First Amendment and are reminded of the freedoms that are afforded to all people in the United States. So that's really what we champion. We also allow reporters to tell stories that they haven't really had the availability to tell in their reporting. It's a way for them to unload their reporter's notebook with these inside stories that folks who love the craft of journalism really get to experience in real life and also in our exhibits.
Great. Speaking of exhibits, I said in a recent post that I could spend a small eternity in the History of News exhibit. What was the process like for developing that exhibit in particular and just the museum's exhibits in general?
We look at the first draft of history primarily. You know, we like to see how that fits into stories of our lives. So it's a process of trying to figure out, for instance, you know, we're doing an ongoing exhibit on the civil rights and the civil rights movement. And every year, you know, going back a couple of years now, but, you know, we're working right now on 1966, and looking at this anniversary year of 1966, now in 2016, of what was happening in the civil rights movement, and getting people to really understand, again, one of the foundation freedoms that are given to them and how they can incorporate that into everyday use. But, I mean, it runs the gamut. We had an Elvis exhibit just a couple of years ago, and people may think, well, what does that have to do with journalism? But, you know, covering rock and roll is
sure
part of journalism, and that's, you know, such a cool story to tell, and it's a gateway into our more serious topics like Journalists in Peril and the Journalist Memorial and the 9/11 Gallery. You know, they're just different entryways. And we also take an approach of what we like to call swimmer, skimmer, diver. We do know that we have a lot of content, and that's why we have a two-day ticket also, because we know that people say, oh, I want to come back. So we say, feel free to come back tomorrow with your ticket. But we look to have the different kinds of people who like to consume information in different ways. Some people want to skim everything. Some people want to dive deeply in different topics. And we want to make sure that they get that in different places of the museum so they are getting the same message.
Yeah, you mentioned the two-day ticket, and someone on our staff said that they went for 2 days and couldn't absorb it, couldn't see all of it. Do you guys have like a strategy guide for dividing and conquering the museum?
We do. We have our top 10 things to see in the museum. We also have guided tours. You know, we do recommend to people to see the museum from the top down, so take the glass elevators all the way up to the top and then work your way down.
Smart.
And that's about a mile and a half of walking, so you know, we know that there's a lot to see. But, you know, you can start with those top 10 things and get an overview maybe on the first day and then decide what things you really want to dive deep in on day two. And also you could become a member and come back as many times as you want.
You know, with journalists, and you've touched on this, with journalists under fire, both literally and figuratively, in the country and around the globe, how is the museum contributing to the discussion about how journalism fits into our culture?
Well, we do have the World Press Freedom Gallery and the Journalist Memorial, and we want people to know that while people, you know, for example, like the 9/11 Gallery, think of that as running towards danger. When something is happening that is critical and even dangerous, while people are fleeing from being journalists, they're going into that so they can tell the story to a wider audience and be able to educate them and hopefully call them to action. And oftentimes that means that journalists get hurt. Mm. But even longer than that, journalists are targeted for the work that they're doing, trying to tell people about misconduct within the government, within, private organizations. They are targeted and often killed. So we do talk about that not only in those galleries of the Journalist Memorial 9/11, but, you know, even in the News History Gallery, we have Don Bowles' car. He's doing a story on the mob in Arizona and was targeted by them. And if it wasn't for a note that he left on his typewriter saying that he was going to meet with one of his sources, nobody would have known and been able to tell that story. So investigative journalism is a dangerous job. And we want people to understand that and understand that when they are buying newspapers, buying magazines, when they're watching the news, that they are supporting that with their money so that those journalists can do more work and deeper work.
All right, that's great. You know, what struck me about that 9/11 exhibit is, you know, quite near it is the exhibit on how the assassination of Abraham Lincoln was covered. And there are eerie parallels between how journalism reacted then and how it reacted in 9/11. And really the only difference was basically technology and the fact that people were able to get their stories out at a much quicker rate. But, you know, journalism has been around for a long time. And what's cool about the museum is that you see how it's progressed from, you know, the typewriter to the internet.
Yeah, speed of news is really something that we cover in depth because, you know, technology changes. And, you know, even in our internet TV and radio gallery, you can see that timeline of, you know, radio coverage and the Hindenburg and listening to that report live to the bombing of London with Theodore Murrow to, you know, breaking news of an election. So those kind of things are covered differently, but so similarly. If good journalism doesn't happen, people don't want to listen.
So from your website, I've learned that you guys are active in the community through forums, educational classes, and educational initiatives. Are there any other ways that the museum is staying connected to the D.C. and national communities?
You know, half of our visitors are school kids, and I think that there's no better way to experience civics than to stand in front of the Berlin Wall and understand history from both East Berlin side and West Berlin side. And our education department has wonderful resources at museum education, our website, which you can go from the museum.org website to experience more and get tools. But we want these stories to come alive. We want to make people remember where they were for big moments in history and remember how news coverage affected that and affected maybe the outcome of, you know, again, going back to civil rights, if it wasn't for reporters talking about the issues, would that story have reached the wider artist audience, and would that story have had a fast enough change if it wasn't for reporting?
Okay, so you're surrounded by a ton of museums, like the mecca of museums in the U.S., many of them free, which differs from the museum, and I think rightfully so. But all these museums in different ways showcase American history. But why is it so important, do you think, to have a museum dedicated specifically to journalism in the nation's capital?
It's easy for me to say in a way because I come from the field of journalism, and you know I think that it's important for people to take a look behind the curtain and to understand what journalists do and how they do it. And while we are a paid ticket in Washington, we're not part of the Smithsonian. We are not funded by your tax dollars, so you are paying tax money to the Smithsonian. So you're paying for that, you know, even if you don't visit it.
Sure.
So, you know, it's important to support things that support the work that allows just Americans to have the freedom that are given to them. So understanding that more deeply in the work that we do to share with the outside public, really, I think is important. And we, you know, we understand it. People say, like, why do we have to pay to come to this museum? And then after spending just an hour, they realize what they're getting, yeah, their return on their investment, if you will. So,
absolutely,
you know, it's a great experience. And we're a private organization, but we're not for profit. Our
right.
goal is not to make a profit.
Exactly. For me, my money was worth seeing David Halberstam's press pass from Vietnam. I mean, I stood in front of that, and I was like, I would have paid $40 to see this.
That's great.
Which actually leads me into my last questions. We usually ask our guests a random fact about themselves, but we're tweaking it a little bit. What's your favorite piece of journalism history that's displayed in the museum?
My favorite piece in the museum is the Watergate break-in door, which I'm not sure if you noticed when you were in the News History Gallery. It's actually the door that the burglars taped open to break into the Watergate building. And, of course, we know from, you know, the Pentagon Papers and from the great movie All the President's Men what journalists did to bring the public that story of Nixon and what his folks were doing. So why I like this is that when the museum made its move from Arlington, Virginia to downtown D.C., there was a news article about it in the paper, and we got a call from the former manager of the Watergate Hotel who said, I have this door in my basement.
Oh my
so what
God.
Happened was when the police came, they took that door as evidence and had the baggie on the doorknob to retain all the fingerprints, that kind of stuff, and it has stickers of evidence on it. After the investigation was over, the police brought that door back to the Watergate Hotel and said, here's your door back. And they had, of course, replaced it because you can't just not have doors on, you know, entryways. So he had it in his basement for a year.
Wow.
And when he saw that the museum was opening in this bigger space, he called us and said, do you have interest in this door? And we said, absolutely.
Yeah.
Curators went over immediately with white gloves and all their, you know, now this is a piece of history. And so this, you know, door that's been sitting in a basement for years now is being picked up and is part of our exhibit. And I think that's so cool. You know, it's awesome to see a Hollywood movie, and, you know, it's great to read all about history and Nixon's impeachment, you know, all this kind of stuff. But to see the door there,
yeah,
with the stacks of the Pentagon Papers, it really makes it all real for somebody who wasn't alive at the time when it was happening.
Right.
When it was happening.
You know, I was so sucked into all the front pages and going through them, I completely missed it, and I'm kicking myself right now. I can't believe I missed that door.
I will send you a picture. Will that make you feel a little bit better?
Yes, absolutely. 100%. So that's it for me. Thank you very much, Sonia, for giving us a little insight into the museum, and you're always welcome back on Writer's Bone.
Well, and you're always welcome to the museum as well. Anytime you want to come back, we'll give you that private tour so you can maybe get a little lay of the land, and maybe we'll give you a behind-the-scenes tour next time, too, for your audio equipment.
I will do that. I can't wait. I'm booking it right now.
Good, good.
All right. Well, thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Yeah.